Check, check, check.
Hi, good morning. Can I request the one sitting a little further away to move closer? Because we're hoping that the session is more of a conversation, so this will be helpful. If it's okay with you, not forcing you to move in the morning. Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for coming to this session. I understand it's early in the morning and it's the third day, but I really appreciate that all of you are here. This is the main session for the Gender Dynamic Coalition, the Dynamic Coalition on Gender and Internet Governance. Usually what the Dynamic Coalitions are free to structure the sessions in ways that they think is most beneficial. We thought that this year it would be interesting if we make the space a learning and knowledge sharing space, and not just to share updates from the Dynamic Coalition's work alone. And today I have my colleague, Dr. Anya Kovacs here, who will be presenting her research on the body as data in the age of datafication. I also have four fantastic discussants with me. Here is Kyung Mi Ho, there is Chennai Sher, there's Dr. Ruhia Seward, and Professor Park will be joining us shortly. I also have my colleagues Baldeep and Vale here, who are rapporturing and helping me moderate this session. So the format with what we have decided is that for about 20 to 30 minutes, Anya will present the research, and then we will have a discussion and a conversation on, and you know, to engage better with the topic. Just a short introduction on why this particular research, and why this particular research in relation to gender and internet governance. One of the main themes of the IGF this year is data governance. And the aim of the data governance track is to basically discuss the fundamental challenges which come in the way of benefiting using data for the benefit of the people. But the truth is also that data collection, data generation, and all of this is not done in a manner which keeps the people at the center of this. Right? So when we're talking about data governance, it's also important to think about the bodies behind data, which is why we thought that this session is particularly important. In specific, with regards to gender, as it is with marginalized communities in the offline space, in the online space as well, when bodies are removed out of the picture, the first groups of people who are affected are the marginalized communities. So in this case, it would be women, it would be queer persons, it would be people who are from non-English speaking backgrounds, who are not from global north countries. So that's just a brief introduction. I will let Anya take over now. Yeah.
Thanks so much, Smita, and also for inviting me to present this work here, which is obviously an amazing opportunity to share these ideas with people like you who are experts in this field already. So my name is Anya, and I work with the Internet Democracy Project in India. We started our work around these issues actually looking at surveillance from a gender perspective specifically, and that was basically with the aim to bring out the more structural aspects of the harms of surveillance and go beyond a debate on privacy alone as the solution to those harms. But as we did that work, questions around data just became stronger and stronger. And what I want to talk about today is a little bit different from the traditional approaches you have to the body and data. We have seen, for example, a lot of work on, say, menstruation apps, right? Where you have a very direct translation of the body into data. What we are actually arguing, though, is that the way data is connected to our bodies today is leading to a fundamental reconceptualization of what our bodies are. And if we do not bring that into the debate on data governance, we are not going to find the right protections for human rights in the digital age. So it's a way, it's not a gendered approach to data, it's a feminist approach to data, where we draw a lot on the research around bodies that is done by feminism and other progressive academic disciplines, but it's not only about gender. What I'm going to present is slightly different from the usual IGF presentation in that there will be a bunch of social theory to start with, but I will come to the policy implications in the end. I'm also quite sure that some of this is going to be familiar for many of you, but I still want to run through it because I think the way we stitch these things together matters. So to come to the point where one can see the validity of the perspective, I think it's just important to run through this. Also, in between, if you want to stop me at any point, have any questions or comments, please do. As Smita said, the idea is to try and make it more interactive, though I guess I am going to talk for a bit. But okay. I think I still want to start from this idea that this intermixing of technology and human beings has the potential for amazing empowerment. We wouldn't be here if we didn't believe in that in a way. But why are we not living in techno paradise yet? After the Second World War, a discipline called cybernetics developed that actually really heavily influenced at how we look at the world today. And it led to two particular shifts. The first one is how we think about data metaphorically and how we speak about it metaphorically. So in cybernetics, and I mean, the image kind of is a hint of the big metaphor that's used today is data is oil, but we also speak about data as a resource, for example, right? The idea in cybernetics, where these ideas come from, is that information informs everything. It's a layer that sits in everything, but in a way, it's also independent from the medium that generates it. So you can take the data out of the thing, and it is not going to change the data or the thing. In that way, then, data becomes something that is out there, that you can mine, that you can grab. We also, because of that conceptualization, we give data enormous power. We say data is the truth, right? Because it is that layer of reflection of reality. And in the most extreme forms, you see these ideas when computer scientists, for example, talk about one day hoping to be able to download a human brain into a computer. The idea is that that human brain would still be the same as if it was in a human being. So the body in which that brain was housed supposedly doesn't matter then to what that brain would be like. Now, I think as feminists, we know that that's not correct in practice. There is a very close interlinking between data and power relations, and these two are closely intertwined in many different ways. The easy examples to see this are cases of context or use discrimination. So if you think of, for example, a nude image, a non-consensually shared nude image of a woman or of a man, of breasts or a dick pic, even though in terms of the data, that's bits and bytes in the same way, right? But we read it very differently because we give a different meaning to it. That's context or use discrimination. There are a number of other forms in which power balances play out, but I want to focus specifically on the ones that have to do with data today, most closely. That is, what we experience today is more and more discrimination by abstraction, right? Where we are actually made into data points. And we often have very little control, first of all, over the data as such. That's problematic, because some people have always been surveilled much more than others, and so there might be overrepresentation. In other cases, we also have underrepresentation. And this is particularly problematic in the age of big data because we rely on the past to predict the future. So the data that we have or do not have matters. Now, I want to give an example here specifically from the context of India, where in the police manual of the state of Karnataka, which is in the south of India, for 4 years, from 2012 onwards, there was a provision that actually allowed the police to predict, to arrest transgender people on the suspicion that they might become a disturbance to public order or peace. And this provision was very broadly worded. It also gave the right to, for the police to have a register of transgender people so that they would know where to go and find them when anything happened in a neighborhood. Now, if you have a provision that focuses so much on a particular social group, then obviously that group is going to be overrepresented in the crime statistics of that state, simply because whenever something happens and the police has to show they're doing something, they're easy people to turn to. We have a few other examples like that in India, including what in colonial times used to be called criminal tribes. Those groups are now not called criminal tribes officially, but again, through regulations and police manuals, they're still under much more heavy surveillance just because of their backgrounds. And what you get and when you build a system of predictive policing is obviously that if you don't correct for these biases, those groups will continue to be targeted disproportionately. But we also have very little control over the categories that we are slotted into, as well as how these categories are formed. And I've used this particular image here. We all know from airports this routine. Now, as feminists, we've been arguing for decades that gender is not a binary, it's a spectrum. But when this happens in an airport, there is no space for the spectrum, right? The space is for the binary, so the police officers who sees you has to decide whether you're male or female, and if they are not sure where you fit, or if they make the wrong choice, you get pulled out of that queue. Now, what if you identify as a woman, but that's not how the officer reads you, and you get patted down by a man? Because that is how the officer did see you, right? These kind of choices where data basically decides who we are, or if somebody else uses data to decide who we are, can put people in really, really vulnerable situations. I don't think you can see this very well, but in any case, there are ample examples like this where even our representation is out of our hands. The images I used are, this was a controversy in India a few years ago, if you Google North Indian masala, so masala is a specific mix of spices in India, if you Google North Indian masala, you get images like these, which are overwhelmingly of food. And if you Google South Indian masala, you get images like these, which are mostly celebrities, models, in various positions. And so, again, the women in these images did not necessarily choose to be represented like this, right? But the control we have over how that happens is becoming increasingly weaker. What is the problem here is really the absence of context, right? Where we just become data points, and then those data points are used to make decisions where we have no control, which can lead to problems in discrimination, representation, and social justice. So why I wanted to outline this in some detail is because I think data as oil makes it sound as if gathering and analyzing data by default is always a good thing. It is always something that should be allowed. We should, since it exists, we should just use it. But talking about bringing back context and bringing back people really reminds us that actually perhaps that shouldn't always be done, even if it is possible, and that not all algorithms have equal value. Right. Any comments or questions so far? The second big shift that's related to this construction of data as a resource is the way that surveillance works. And bodies have always been central to surveillance, but they are not anymore in the same way as surveillance as we used to know it. The way we talk about surveillance in many ways, I think at least until the Snowden revelations, was still very much the image on the right, Big Brother is watching you, which is surveillance as monitoring. It's watching what you have done or you are currently doing. When we used to talk about surveillance and security, that was often the approach, and a lot of the laws in many of our countries actually still cater to that more traditional form of surveillance. And we had a fairly stable balance around, I think, consensus in many countries about how that should work in the 90s. Of course, By then already, surveillance had started to shift. That image on the right is a panopticon, which was designed by Jeremy Bentham in the late 18th century as a jail where the guard would stand in the middle and the prisoners would be all around. And the prisoners would never know whether the guard could actually see them or not. And then the idea is that you would adjust your behavior, right? And this model was made popular again thanks to Foucault, who saw it as central to all modern institutions, hospitals, schools, where the idea that you're being watched actually incentivizes some kind of behaviors and discourages others. And so then surveillance became both preemptive, that it's kind of prevented us from doing things in the first place, so you don't have to go and look at what people did, but also productive because it makes us do other things. It influences our choices. And we see now that these possibilities have become even more extensive with big data. I guess the most controversial example nowadays is around elections and how they actually influence voter behavior. But there are also the examples of social sorting, the categories that you're put in, for example, to decide credit scores for insurance purposes, et cetera, right? All of these are related to this. We also know the disciplinary power of the cyber gaze, of course, in a much more personal way. I think many of us have kind of thought, oh, why did you put up that picture on Facebook? I look so terrible in it. It's actually the same logic at work. But surveillance isn't just that anymore. It's really fundamentally changing in what two scholars, Hagerty and Erickson, have called the surveillance assemblage. Does anybody know what that image is?
I'm a literary studies person, and it looks like a riser.
Yes.
Continental.
Yes, exactly. It is a rhizome. So that's those weeds where on the top you can't see it, but underneath actually the roots are all connected. What Hagerty and Erickson argued is that this is really the model of surveillance today and the fundamental change. And what we have now is not anymore earlier where you had the guard in the middle or the government watching what you were doing. Surveillance is actually a system that always has multiple actors working together. And if, for example, you use a Fitbit or any of these apps that like check things that have to do with your bodily data, you are a node in that surveillance system as well, right? You are contributing to that data yourself. You play a role in that. So you always have multiple actors. What has become important now is the data flows and who is able to capture those data flows and what they are able to do with that. Now, that's also fluid. Not every actor will have the same power to capture or the same interest at different points in time. But we can see that slowly there are nodes emerging that actually are being more institutionalized and have the power to capture a lot of that flow and then use that flow or the data they have captured in that flow to direct or govern the behavior from others. How is this different from the surveillance that we used before? Well, first of all, because it's everywhere, which we are quite conscious of in a way, right? And that's one of the reasons we have an IGF about focusing on data. What's also really different, though, is that it doesn't need to see us in our totality anymore. This idea of like total body vision doesn't matter anymore. There is a specific purpose why a specific actor wants to be able to surveil us, and what they need is to be able to get hold of that bit of us. So in that sense also, like the context of our life is really denuded on purpose. That's part of the way that system works. It's also fundamentally unstable because it is about flows and actors who manage to grab flows in between. And that means that our earlier forms of resistance to surveillance can't work in the same way anymore. We have to recognize that this is a different paradigm if we want to be effective in resisting it. If you look at this from a feminist perspective, the difference is then that our body is broken down into information, right? That's really, that disassembling is really what is different now. And that is done to make it mobile and comparable and use those bits to make decisions about our lives, about who we are. That means that surveillance is much more dispersed, but also fundamentally distributed unevenly. We are not subject to the same gaze anymore, as again in these earlier two forms of surveillance, there was still much more similarity. Now, even your income can determine what you see on Google, for example, as search results, right? There are fundamental differences that we aren't even conscious of as societies because it's so hard to see these. The opaqueness of all of this is really a big problem, both in terms of how algorithms work and of how surveillance work. Right, so that's all really depressing. But maybe there is hope. And so what we are arguing is that the way out of this conundrum really is, at least in part, to put bodies back at the center. And why are we saying that? There is a Dutch scholar called Irma van der Ploeg who has been arguing that actually the line between our physical body and our virtual body is becoming irrelevant. And so that's why at the Internet Democracy Project, we don't talk about data doubles, we talk about data as being embodied, which is a different perspective, a different emphasis. Where does our embodied experience of data really matter? I'll give you a few examples. The first one is a story. A few years ago, there was an American academic who did an experiment with a transgender friend who had just had a sex change operation from male to female and now had breasts. They were in the state of Florida, where the law says that if you're a man, you can drive around topless in a car, but if you're a woman, you cannot. Now, the person's driving license still said that they were male, even though they had breasts, so they decided to do an experiment and see whether the law would pull them up or not. They were stopped by a police officer, but they were let go because the driving license said the person was male. This is one example where clearly the physical and the virtual, what is really determining who we are, even if you're standing in front of the person as a physical person. Another case also from Florida, which has been great in giving us examples, it seems. This is a really sad case, though. It's a bit controversial how it played out, but the bit I wanted to get out here is there was a woman who filed a rape case against a man, and that rape had happened at night when they were together in a house, and her Fitbit data was used to undermine her testimony that she was asleep at the time when she claimed that the rape happened. And so in the end, like I said, it was a messy case, it was thrown up out. But again, this is a fundamental change in how we deal with these things, right? Because earlier this would not have been possible as an individual in that situation at that point of the day. We wouldn't have had data to check the verity of what you were saying. So again, her story about the physical was disowned and the data was what was believed. And then an extreme case from India, an extreme example perhaps. This is, we have in India a unique identification system called Aadhaar. You need an Aadhaar number to get benefits from the government that people have a right to under the law. And specifically in ration shops, what has happened is, so this is an image of a ration shop. People who have a right to these rations go to a ration shop where the owner might have known them for 30 years and know that they are who they say that they are. But because the biometric identification that comes with Aadhaar fails, and the system does not recognize who they are, they do not get their data. The numbers, absolute numbers, are not very large, but half of all starvation deaths in India since 2015 have been blamed on biometric identification failures through Aadhaar and people who did not get their rations as a consequence. So again, we are living in a world where increasingly data is used to determine our bodily experiences to such an extent that we cannot continue to talk about this as something that is out there independently from us. And this is really a fundamental paradigm shift. I think that's really important to understand. What van der Ploeg said, I think it's difficult to see these things while you're in it, though the more stories we unearth like that, the more we can sense that. If you look at the Middle Ages in Europe, for example, before and after scientists started to cut open people's bodies and look at what was going on inside, the way we talked about bodies, the way we imagined bodies, the way we conceptualized them was completely different. So many of the ways in which we talk about PMS today, for example, hormones, all of these things which we use to explain, translate our experiences were not possible until science started to cut open people. And the way we talked about bodies before that was much more true, like mystical, religious metaphors, etc., etc. It didn't just determine the body then, it really determined our experience of the world in a wider sense as well. Of course, Europe was a bit late. In the Arab world, for example, they had actually been cutting people open much later, but I'm using that example because it's quite well known. Yes, so really a paradigm shift, and that's also why I said in the beginning that I think we need to start integrating. This is early days, so how that plays out in practice is not that easy yet to say. But we are at the Internet Democracy Project trying to start to think through then what does it mean. And I don't think it's not as if we're going to radically start thinking differently about protections. I do think we can give more depth, and in some cases we can ask questions that at the moment do not seem to be on the table. For us, it's like the body becomes a starting point to read that surveillance assemblage and then see what, as our experience from data teaches us, do we need to change in how that surveillance assemblage works to actually make sure that as human beings we feel our human rights, our dignity are respected. And with this line between the physical and the virtual disappearing, it really means we need to start looking at different protections, right? Because all these examples that I give, data protection legislation is not going to solve these, right? In its own, that's never going to be enough. Some of these are questions of bodily integrity, for example. Another case in which you can see this really stark is the way we deal in most countries with non-consensual sharing of sexual images is actually as a privacy or a data protection violation. If you speak to the mostly women or sexual minorities with whom that has happened, they speak of this in terms of sexual assault. The harm of assault is never addressed in our law, right? It is a physical, direct experience that people have of this. And so again, at the moment, our laws do not allow for that to be addressed because we do not make this connection. To end, I want to briefly run you through some of the thinking we have started to do around consent from this perspective of the embodied experience of data, so consent and the way it is treated in data governance legislation at the moment, just to give you like a teaser of where we hope this will go. I've always found it really interesting that you can sign consent away with a box. There is no other fundamental right that we can sign away ticking a box. You can't sign away your freedom of expression ticking a box, right? The reason we can do that is because we treat consent in data protection as we do in contract law. It's about modulating more narrowly the flows of information and have better informed input from consumers, but really this is about preventing liability for consumers. It is not fundamentally about the consent of the individuals involved. What if we actually start to think about consent again the way we do around bodies in feminism, around sexual relations, for example, right? In India, at some point in the debate around our draft data protection legislation, there was one scholar who suggested that we would do away with consent altogether, and we would have only an accountability framework. People were outraged about this, but I was the one who asked, but on what ground are you so outraged? Because if you treat data as a resource in that disembodied way, that's a completely acceptable approach. Actually, philosophically, you don't have a ground to stand on to say that this is not acceptable. For us, bringing the body back in makes it clear immediately why consent in the digital age and in the age of datafication remains so important. And so if you think of consent, I mean, this is Planned Parenthood. It's not, I think, exactly what how we would frame it in the context of data, but still, consent has to be negotiable to be meaningful if we think about consent in a deeper way. It has to be, you need to have all the information you need to make informed consent. It's best understood when it expands only incrementally, and when you build a relationship of trust, right? In sexual relationships, this is part of the debate always. It's not because you've kissed somebody that you want to sleep with them. This goes step by step, but somehow on the internet, the idea is that you have to sign away from the outside everything and then just accept. And also that consent is always based on a constant flow of information and transparency, which is a back and forth, and where you have moments to reevaluate, which again, on the internet at the moment, often we do not have. Some of this though, I think if you look, for example, at the GDPR, there are already attempts to start addressing this. So in India, for example, the draft bill that we have under discussion right now does not allow you to ask for a full copy of the data that a data controller has over you. But I know that in the GDPR, for example, that does happen. And I think some of these rights are ways to kind of try and implement consent in a more meaningful way. But I think putting the body back also in the debate really encourages to take a more structural approach to these questions, right? Because the problem with how we talk about consent now is also that it really individualizes this issue. The consent puts the burden completely on you as an individual, the way we treat it now in data protection. Again, in other human rights, that doesn't necessarily happen. And one interesting example, I think, or important example, is you can't sign away your right to life even if you want. In most democratic societies, I think all democratic societies that I know of, you can't sign yourself into slavery or bonded labor. That's not something you can consent to. The idea is that there is an essence to human dignity that one needs to preserve, and that we are aware that conditions might put people in a position to agree to, but that societies we have said we still need to try and work against this. And in India, for example, we have bonded labor in practice still happening, but it is not legal. I think this is a way to start thinking about consent as well. Are there parts where that modulation of information flows should not even be allowed to happen? Are there questions that should not be allowed to ask? Is there data that should not be allowed to gather? And one, for me, really striking example, and that's also why this image is up there. So that image is from 18th or 19th century. You know, when there was a whole, in part driven by colonialism, disciplines that measured people's heads to kind of claim whether they would be criminal, whether they would be, in this case, reliable mothers, etc. There were two scientists, one of whom was at Stanford, who developed an algorithm to predict people's sexual orientation based on their face. This was an academic paper published a few years ago. How on earth is it possible that that question can even be asked in the 21st century? It's actually a repeat of these things. Well, when we now talk about colonialism, we're all outraged that these things could happen at that time, right? That you could measure people's faces and then classify them in categories like that. And actually, with facial recognition, a lot of these exercises are happening all over again. So I think really what we need to start thinking of is, what are some of the things that should not be allowed to ask, to be done, etc.? And again, I think if we put bodies and the embodied experience of data of different people back at the center of the debate, that we are going to find it easier to move in a direction where we can actually find answers to these questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anya. That was fantastic. We'll start with some questions from our discussants.
Or comments.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm K.S. Park, a law professor from Korea, also director of OpenNet Korea, which is a digital rights organization. Again, confirms my fear that you can never fully understand French philosophers. Very hard to penetrate. There are so many questions. I don't know where to begin. Because it was very profound and very all-encompassing. I was given the idea that we're going to talk about body and data. I received a text on data sovereignty, as in sovereignty of a nation. So I was thinking about that, but the presentation itself is about, again, body and data. So I'll ask you questions about body and data. Although all this has implications for the data sovereignty talk that the Indian government has been pushing, apparently. So I guess the first question is strengthening the link between bodies and data, or putting data back into bodies. I think that it has the fallacy of actually strengthening the Indian government's propaganda for data sovereignty and the push for data localization, which has been actually used and used by different authoritarian governments to facilitate surveillance on their own people and censorship on their own people. Because if servers hosting postings or social media comments are domestically are domesticated, then they can much easier respond to, they are much more easily subjected to censorship orders from the local government. So there is that. So now I made a connection between data sovereignty and body and data. Now, coming back to the main theme of body and data, data as the extension of a body, I think can be exemplified in the case of face recognition, for instance, where it's not just other, it's not just biometric card. Now they don't even need a card. They can just, they just have extracted enough data points so that just showing up somewhere brings with you all the data about you that are linked to the facial data sets. So in that sense, I think that your demand for better protection or some protection aside the data protection law does make sense. Having said that, if you really think about it, facial recognition is something that we have done even from prehistoric ages. When a human being meets another human being in the forest, you know, fully naked, without any tools, the first thing the human beings have evolved to learn was to recognize one another. So you know that all human beings have the, and also vertebrate animals have evolved to learn to recognize one another by looking between the eyes. That's where you recognize a person. So facial recognition, modern facial recognition, is different from the primordial face recognition. Well, in terms of scale, basically the number of faces that one can recognize. I mean, probably I can recognize less than 20,000 faces, but with the face recognition tool, where we aggregate the memories of faces of several hundred people or several million people, now I can recognize probably billion people. And that's what the Chinese government is doing to recognize their own billion people, pulling facial data sets. But my question then is, do we need something higher, some other qualitative protection from data protection law when we look at, for instance, facial recognition? If you really disassemble the problem of facial recognition, there are two problems. One is faces have a unique identification power that go beyond any of other national identifiers. At the same time, what's unique about faces is that even with such identifying power, you wear them out, you make them available publicly when you walk around. See, you don't walk around showing your social security numbers. You don't walk around showing your Aadhaar number, but face you wear out. Actually, you cover every part of your body except your face, although you know that the sunlight will make you look older through UV rays, but you choose to only make your face available for other people's inspection. Why do we do that, right? There's a reason for doing that. So how do we deal with this problem of wearing out on your sleeves the data that has such strong identifier power? And we can learn a little bit from the literature and study on license plate numbers, because that's another area where the data that has strong identity power are made available publicly to visual inspection. And also the area of, a subset of data protection jurisprudence is about prevention of a function creep. The more identifiable or the more identifying power data has, the less functions have to be built upon it. So like right here in Germany, you need a separate number for medical services, separate number for libraries, separate number for education. Back in Korea, with one number, when you borrow a book from local library, you need a resident registration number. The same number gets you medical services, education services, all of that. So Korea is a really bad example of not having prevented the function creep. So what I'm trying to say is, maybe we don't need to be so apocalyptic about how data has been disembodied. There is enough literature, movement on foot about how to reduce function creep and what to do with public exposure of strong identifying data. Now, my final point is this. You talked about doing away with the consent, but the real power of data protection law is not really consent. The real power of data protection law is what the default position is if there is no consent. The idea is that at least the fiction that data protection law wanted to impose upon ourselves is that we own our data, which means that if there is no consent, then that data cannot be used by anybody else. So it's the default position that's really important for the consent regime. It's not the consent that is really, if the consent was important, then we didn't have to push for the mantra that we own data about ourselves, or we own our own data. But the reason that we push for data ownership as the metaphor for data governance was because, you know, when you find something, you know, when you find these glasses lying on the ground, you will think that it probably is owned by somebody. So to pick that up, you will need the consent from somebody else. So there is a lot of talk about how the consent not being efficient a governance tool. But when you are throwing away consent, maybe you are throwing away the baby with the water. Because you need that default position. The default position that you cannot use data unless you consult or you obtain consent from the owner. Now, my personal view is that data ownership is only a metaphor, and I think it has to be moderated. If you mechanistically apply data ownership, the idea of data ownership, you end up with a paradoxical result like right to be forgotten or restriction on data flow that actually works against vulnerable people. We in Korea have something stronger than right to be forgotten, which is the truth of defamation. And that has been abused by male perpetrators of sexual assaults to silence Me Too revelations. And many women have been threatened with a defamation lawsuit. And there, the idea is that, you know, everyone owns data about him or herself, so even truthful, non-privacy infringing facts can be suppressed. That extension of the data ownership idea has to be somehow contained. So on that, I wanted to seek your opinion. Okay, thank you.
Should we take
questions? Yeah. More questions, comments?
Unless Bill, you want to talk to the specimens first.
Okay.
Thank you so much. My name is Liz Orembo from the Kenya ICT Action Network. The idea of data governance is so passionate to me. I'm doing a research on digital lending that uses the concepts of collecting data from your phone to measure what amount of loans that you might be able to get just from the data points from your phone. So I think we should strike a balance between the usage of data to our advantage and the dangers of using the same data. I'm speaking from the point that the body and with the different genders that that we might be displaying offers various data points to which they're so connected to the society and the cultural norms that are out there. And if they come out, then they will, they have the potential of stigmatizing or causing harms to the individuals who own this data. And so I see this subject as a very critical one to see where we can strike a balance between the harms of data and at the same time allowing the different genders learn about their bodies and actually taking advantage of these data points and the information that they have, irregardless which applications that they use, be it Fitbit, be it the menstrual cycle one, and all those kind of data. So I am thinking maybe when you're going to research, we see the different data principles, the principles of minimalization, specification, That's with time and purpose specification and consent. If we can divide our researches into these principles and how they can practically be implemented within the various applications that we are using. Yeah.
Thank you. We'll take one more question from one of the discussants, and then maybe Anya could answer three of them. Yeah. Chennai?
Yeah, so this is, I always, my name is Chennai for the transcript, and I always find this work fascinating. I've listened to Anya speak to it before, and Liz mentioned something around the context and cultural norms, and you had also talked about how context is taken out of when we think about data points. So I guess the question for me is, whilst we're all here thinking about it from that, well, personally speaking, from that feminist and end-user perspective, my question is always around the actual designers of these systems that require the data. Have you had the opportunity, who may not be feminist, to actually engage with them to see how they think about what they think, what they would say is the resource that they need as data, to actually ask them, and I know there's a lot of innovations around AI for good, AI for, to algorithms to respond to social issues, but I think the question there is from the developer's perspective, do they see this body aspect, or would they consider the body as a distraction from what they really want to get, which is data to do good in society?
Okay. Anya?
So I think maybe to start with something that speaks in a way to all of these questions, even or comments, because I think yours was more a comment, right? Your input was more a comment than a question, I think, right? I completely agree with you. But so I think for us, the starting point is if we think about privacy also, I don't think we're always very clear in data governance what we're really talking about. And I think you also see that still in the courts that actually the specific definition of privacy is very vague. And the definition that we use in the Internet Democracy Project is privacy as boundary management. So what that means is that what we need to preserve the human dignity, autonomy, et cetera, that privacy is supposed to protect is the ability to actually have some control over our boundaries, over what we share with whom, at what point in time. And that's essential to have the space where you can develop. If you live in a society where norms are such that, for example, your gender identity is not something you can easily develop freely, you need to have that very interior space where you can be on your own and be, you're never completely out of society, obviously, right? But where you're not under direct influence of these forces, to kind of start developing your own perspectives, etc. That is really what boundary management or privacy for us is about. But it's also always dynamic, right? Because you develop relationships with people over time, and then you give them more information as you trust them. Coming to KS's point about facial recognition, so I think this also works actually with faces. And I do think what we see today with facial recognition is qualitatively completely different from what existed before. I would come out on the street, yes, and you could see my face, but you could not come up to me and say, hey, what's your name? And me just giving that information, right? This was just not happening. And in India, actually, there is a, I think many people know Gandhi, who used to say during the freedom struggle, he would call on Indian people to go back to the villages because that was supposedly the more authentic way of living an Indian life. But at the same time, there was a great public intellectual called Dr. Ambedkar, who also is the father of the Indian constitution, and was a Dalit leader, a person from the lowest caste in the Hindu system. He called on people to go and live in cities, because his argument was that you would never be able to escape casteism if you would stay in villages, precisely because you would always already be known. You would appear in public and people would have all this other data about you. And his argument was that in cities, even though you are out in the street, you're publicly visible, but because that entire ecosystem of data around you is not easily accessible in the same way in a city, there is a way to escape that discrimination, that oppression that comes with caste. this is something we are fundamentally undermining. And when it comes to facial recognition, I mean, that anonymity that actually big cities at the end of the day give many people, and for many people are still, despite all the shortcomings of big cities, no, why do many people still prefer to live there? It has a lot to do with the anonymity we at least perceived was accessible to us there as well. This is really going. That's fundamentally different. On that particular question of facial recognition, I also think it's really interesting how differently we see treatment of this question starting to emerge in different societies, right? In the US and several states, there are efforts to severely restrict at least the use of facial recognition. In India, after that famous gang rape that happened in 2012 that many people might have heard of, there was a massive fund installed by the Indian government to actually deal with projects of women's safety. The overwhelming amount of those funds is being used to install CCTV cameras and facial recognition systems in Indian cities, all in the name of women's safety. But that most definitely is not just going to be used for women's safety. The police in the South Indian state of Hyderabad has been walking up to workers, laborers who are standing in the street waiting to get work for that day and recording their facial data to insert in databases. Not on any legal ground, but also not illegal. There is nothing that stops them from doing this, right? So again, I think like we see that the legitimacy of this is questioned in different countries in very different ways, and the way it is implemented and rolled out is also different in different countries. There is space to still intervene, but for me that is a fundamentally different, qualitatively, not just quantitatively, different from what used to go before. Yes, so on the cultural issue, I guess, that's where that question of boundary management comes in for me really importantly. We used to think of, that was never perhaps fully correct, but in many ways you think of the boundary of your body as where your skin touches the air. But I don't think of the boundary of my body like that anymore. No, I'm aware of the fact that there is all this data out. And so if you start to think in terms of boundary management and put bodies back into the debate, I don't think we will ever get these strict lines, even if we imagine it like that. Like that border is never going to be so, it never was, and it definitely isn't in the digital age going to be so neat. But then the question is, how do you build systems where that fuzziness is such that as an individual, you still have a say in how that expands, where that goes, with who you share what at what point of time? And the problem at the moment is that many of us don't. I also think it's really problematic that we focus so much, for example, on sensitive data and other personal data. If somebody on Facebook told me that they actually often can see that somebody is going to become depressed, heavily depressed, several months in advance. That's not because you're writing down that you're depressed, right? So if you're only going to protect sensitive data, like that data is, for them to draw that conclusion is not protected because that's based on data that will not be protected. It will not be sensitive enough to get that level of protection. These are ways in which through data protection legislation at the moment we think we have protections which we actually don't. There was one more comment I wanted to make. Just because you used that, I'm not going to address the sovereignty question because it's a big debate and we've written a paper about it, which KS has read and you guys have not, so I think it would be a bit tedious. But we never use data ownership as a metaphor in the Internet Democracy Project. I think it's deeply flawed. It's extremely limited. What matters linked to that idea of privacy as boundary management is to have a certain level of control and to be able to have trust in the systems that you find yourself in. But ownership as such just feeds into the very extractive logic of data capitalism today that creates some of these problems in the first place. Chennai, I'm not sure I addressed your question. Developers. I think in all places, I'm sure this is going to be inconvenient, but what has been really interesting for me is that in India, it took conversations, but some of the people who have been most who have been very vocally supportive of our work are actually very privileged men who took some time but then saw a point and thought we need to do something with this. We need to start making space for this somehow. So, yes, not a definitive answer, but.
Sorry, you've had your hand up for a while, but.
Yeah, I'll make it short. Thank you very much, and thank you for the interesting session. I have a question. Are there any suggestions or thinking around also recourse? So we're talking about sort of protecting and preventing, which is, of course, incredibly important. We know about the right to be forgotten, but are there other reflections on this? I give a really quick example. About 4 or 6 years now, more or less, I've been trying to get rid of a Twitter handle that's tied to an account I can't access anymore. And every answer has been stupid. Quite simply, just, you know, it's either because it's coming from a prison in Alabama or who knows. But there's not much at stake. But of course, if you're somebody depending on welfare benefits, there's a lot at stake, as we saw with the India case. What are the reflections in the community around those kinds of issues? So a little bit downstream in terms of once data has been collected, what are the measures that are in place or are being thought about?
Thank you. Youngmi and then
Baldi. Yeah, okay, my name is Youngmi Oh from Open the Korea. Before my question, please note that my questions are based on Dr. Anya's thesis. Okay, yeah. Korea is not too different from the situation of India, and because the internet-based technology and culture have been established by the government-led industrialization process. And so your thesis was very interesting. And I have two questions. And I think my first question is a bit fundamental. And both of questions are from the perspective of feminism. And at the beginning of the article, you said you would lay out feminist politics of data as a theoretical framework. However, this theoretical framework is mentioned briefly in the introduction, but you did not mention it specifically again in the text. So can you elaborate more specifically on the theoretical framework of feminist politics? Why did you want to take this theoretical framework? And I have also curiosity about the benefits of choosing feminist politics as the theoretical framework. I think this is very important. And as far as I understand the paper, citizens who are producing data are alienated from the use of data by government and the technological capital. Yeah. And in the middle of the paper, you gave an example that this arrangement of forces can cause HIV patient to give up the treatment. So I have a question, another question. Have you ever had any interesting or pessimistic examples involving women in data production and alienation like HIV cases in India? And I ask you like that, but I think I got answers already through your announcement at the beginning of it's like a feminist perspective. And yeah, okay, that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Baldi?
Hello, everyone. My name is Baldeep. I'm a researcher in critical media studies, and I'm a historian of science. I want to quickly add some nuances to some of the things that you said, and I have a question for Anya. So you talked about facial recognition, and there's some historical context here that I think would be very useful for our discussion. First of all, you talked about like primal facial recognition, how we recognize each other as humans, and I personally think it's a little bit of an ableist position to take because I'm on the spectrum. I read faces very differently than you do. It's a very different data point for me. So I would not go about essentializing that. And in terms of when you said that, oh, well, faces are always exposed, well, so are hands. and the history of this relationship between fingerprinting and facial recognition is super interesting. Like in the case of India, for example, when the British Raj started opium plantations in Bengal, the white officials could not differentiate between Indians because they couldn't read the faces. And that's the beginning of the British Empire's engagement with fingerprinting. They would take entire prints of the hand, because what the Indian natives would do is, if a police officer wants to arrest someone, they'll send somebody else because they're not going to know the difference. And so fingerprinting became really crucial for the empire to regulate bodies in that sense. So I feel like it doesn't work if we conflate them, if we treat them as the same thing, if we treat fingerprinting and facial recognition as the same thing, because there's a colonial context and we have to recognize that certain bodies were fingerprinted before others. And this case of the opium plantation in the history of fingerprinting is taken to be the first ever case of biometric identification. So this is before digital, this is 300 years ago, very analog. And the question that I had for Anya comes from like my obsession with thinking about media and how that works as an interface between bodies and data. And what I was thinking about is, of course I agree with everything that you said, but I also have to think about data has its own body too. It's stored on something and bodies are datafied via something. And when you were talking about Haggerty, Erickson, and Deleuze, I also thought about Mark Fisher, because he talks about, in the university context, how the cell phone screen is a disciplinary mechanism, because students in his class were always looking at the cell phone, even though they didn't know why they were looking at it. So the screen in itself is disciplining them. And it's very interesting, because recently in the Silicon Valley, in these super privileged families of tech people, there has been this social move where they want to wean their kids off of screens. So I feel like the tools that datafy us, or the tools that we consent to being datafied by, are also contingent on the amount of privilege that we have. Because in India, people are obsessed with screens, right? Because they're taking them somewhere. So I was wondering what you would have to say about that. How do we think critically about datafying tools and mediums, and how do they use us between this entire relationship between body and data?
Thank you, Baldeep. Dr. Ruhia, do you also want to add some comments and questions, and then Anya can take them together? Thank you.
Hi. So as a political scientist and someone who works in research and policy, I tend to think in kind of a macro way about this contestation over ideas. And it kind of picks up on some of the things that people have asked, but so just bear with me, which is like so those bodies at the center that we're talking about, each of those bodies actually has their opinions about how they should live. You know, they're entrepreneurs, they are policemen, they are government ministers. And, so for instance, I mean, bear with me as I say this, but, you know, this idea of data as a resource or data as the new oil really emerged out of a neoliberal discourse that thought that, data is feeding into a lot of innovation ecosystems and actually helping people to, I'm not necessarily in agreement with this, but it's feeding a lot of potential, innovation in a positive way and bringing, money to the people, the entrepreneurs that are using it. So I see that, even in our legal systems, like we have a contestation over ideas, and how do we, as a community of people all over the world, 7 billion people, how do we come to some agreement? So, a feminist activist might say that those CCTV cameras are useful for preventing harms. So there's like this security narrative, there's this innovation narrative, and then there's this kind of digital rights or human rights narratives, and these do not always intersect. So how do we come to some kind of policy and legal systems that balance those narratives, when in fact many people would say that kind of neoliberalism has lifted people out of poverty and done all these amazing things, and we might not agree with that, but we have to exist and develop policies and do research in that kind of framework where We have to debate and come to things that matter. So you, if security on the internet matters to you, then you care about those issues. And if digital rights matter to you, then you care about those issues. If you are an entrepreneur, then you want access to that data. So how do we balance these competing narratives? I mean, that would be my main thing. And then in addition to that, I find that so many things that we do, we kind of stumble into unintended consequences of laws that we pass. And we can see that with the CCTV example and the way that it becomes a surveillance tool when it's really meant to be a sort of security piece to prevent harms, right? So there's all these unintended consequences to everything that we do. And then when it comes to like data governance challenges, I mean, for instance, when I'm thinking of data as embodiment, you know, we've been talking a lot about kind of data trusts as a way of, as a tool for better data governance. And I'm, and maybe you might not know or have an answer to this, but I'm wondering how the idea of data as embodiment could feed in or be leveraged in a kind of data trust context as an institutional tool. So anyways, I'm throwing a bunch of things at you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, to some of this, I have no answers. And that's also because we've been working on this. I mean, we started thinking about it a year and a half ago. We started properly working on it about 6 months ago. So it's very new. And that's also why, for me, these inputs are really useful, because there are a lot of ideas and pointers here of direction. So on Baldeep's point, I think that's a great thing to talk about, think about. We didn't yet. I'm going to follow up on this, but so we should chat more. It just made me think also, though, about how, like, for example, if you use apps or like Fitbits, things like that, people who use those often say that it really also like changes their behavior, right? And that even often changes their intuition, like even though they feel whatever. If you see that you haven't slept enough, you feel tired because the data is saying you haven't slept enough. Like that you check in with the data almost before you check in with how you actually feel. And that there's really interesting qualitative research on this for people who say at some point I just stopped using it because that was freaking me out, that I was actually privileging the data to such an extent. But this is what we do as society in general right now, right? We privilege data. So at an individual level, obviously, that's going to happen as well. That's something I had to think about, but I know it's not exactly what you're saying. That's still different. So, and the same with the recourse question. Actually, you made me realize, like, yes, we've really been focusing on protections, and we haven't really thought about, like, what when it goes wrong, what next? So we will do that. If you have ideas, please let me know. Like, I'd love to talk more about that. On the competing narratives, so I do think we still have those competing narratives because this is still a space in flux, right? And there is I mean, it's not that it's ever going to go away, but I hope there is still space to change some of this. And it comes back a little bit to the question Chennai was asking as well. So among the things that we are starting to look at right now, just to give you a sense, because I think that's where, for me, part of the pushback will come from is, so we are looking at data colonialism as well. There are scholars who have drawn parallels between historic colonialism and data colonialism, not at a metaphoric level, but actually at the structural level of how these things are happening. And one of the things that they have pointed to is how surveillance capitalism really is built on extraction of resources, in this case then data, in a very intense way. And with data, surveillance capitalism has access to parts of our lives that it didn't before, because our social relationships, the most intimate thoughts we have, the things we worry about, all of that is now being commodified as well. And they make, those scholars make parallels between how that happens and how then that data is described as being something that's up for grabs, and how in historic colonialism, land where people have been living for millennia was described as terra nullia, because either the people didn't claim ownership in the right way, or they were wiped out by diseases in any case. And you have these instances where I think the Spanish conquistadores in Latin America read out in Spanish announcements of what they were set out to do, and there was no response, obviously, because people didn't understand Spanish. And then those lands were taken over. And they're making parallels with the terms and conditions that we are signing today. Most of the equivalence they are drawing is actually between land and extraction and data. But what we are starting to look into is whether we can also make a connection between slavery and the extraction of bodies physically and data today. And I think for me, so that's a very complex debate, but I think historically that kind of commodification of bodies we've also seen in the whole debate about organ transplantation. For example, which is really interesting, in the 18th century, grave robberies were quite common because you could get money for organs and there was no regulation yet. No, but this is what of, like, so there were entrepreneurs who thought that this was a great idea because there wasn't anything stopping them. And then there was a whole debate about, so why is this an issue? How does this affect the dignity of people? And you've seen that continue also with organ donation and bioethics. In India, the debate around surrogacy has been very strong. So we're trying to kind of look at all of these debates to see what are lessons we can learn there if we think, because in a way, this datafication is a different form of commodification, which, like almost all forms of commodification, to some extent we happily partake in, and to some extent we feel might undermine our human dignity at a very profound level. So then where does that shift, and what do we need to have in place to shift it? And I think for me, so like when you talk about innovation, et cetera, like I don't want to stop innovation. I just want to stop innovation that goes at the expense of people's dignity, right? And I think that question is just not in the debate right enough right now. And it's hard to put it there because with the language of data as a resource, you just don't see the challenges clearly enough. We are saying they're winning that debate, and well, but so I mean, there's quite a few people in this room, which is great. And then on the point about the data sovereignty issue, so basically what we are trying to do is use this framework and apply it in different areas and then see what would it mean for policy, how would it shift things. And one place we looked at was data sovereignty in the context of India, which is used as an example, as a framework to push for data localization. What we tried to say in the paper, and I'm sorry if it didn't come out enough, but was really that the starting point is for the Indian government to make the claims it does is based on the use of data as a resource. And I think this, I'll come back to again and again. I really think like the data protection legislation in India is really weak. Actually, consent is a ground for processing in very few cases. There are a ton of other grounds that take up much more space. And if you ask like why is India going to pass probably a fairly sloppy data protection law? Because we talk about data as a resource. That's for me really why. It might make sense in Europe to have much stronger protections, but if you look at data as a resource, if that is your narrative in the context of a country where India can actually foster growth through claiming, building a data ecosystem within the country, building an industry on top of that, and having as few barriers to that as possible. That's true. So in a way, I think what the Indian government is doing is taking the debate on data as a resource to its logical conclusion. And because there is no other language available, like what in this particular economic context, what arguments will you have to stand on except, I don't know. I think we don't have any. So in a way, on the data sovereignty issue, that really is the point, that the language they use is that of a resource, and then you get a form, a narrative around data sovereignty that doesn't question, for example, that very extractive logic of data colonialism. And if you don't question that extractive logic of data colonialism or surveillance capitalism, whatever you want to call it right now, if we don't start questioning that, then this bodily integrity is not going to be put back on the table, because that is part of the problem. The idea that we can commodify every single aspect of our inner life, that there is nothing that has to be preserved that should not be accessible to being captured in those information flows that I was talking about earlier. So in that way, we try to make the link to say, like, we need to put bodies back in, and the starting point is seeing what happens when you don't.
Thank you, Anya. Just a sec, I have a quick comment and then I can come to you. When we're talking about bodies, it's also because the question about CCTV cameras for safety came up, and I think I was talking to both of you yesterday about it. When we talk about CCTV cameras and technology and data collection as of now, it is largely in the binaries. And the construction of it, it's the question of can binary code really hold non-binary identities, right? Because when you talk about CCTV cameras, the point of surveillance is because you're surveilling certain bodies. And your assumption is that bodies are in two genders, male and female. And the female bodies are more often than not harmed by the male bodies. But then what happens when someone doesn't fit in either of these categories, right? And who are the people who are left in the gap of this? A very small example is a couple of years ago, I was taking a cab booked by one of these apps, and I faced assault when I was in the cab. When I tried to file a complaint with the company, they took the complaint after much annoyance. And after speaking to them for about an hour, hour and a half, they said that they'll come back to me with more questions. And by that time, I was already presenting in the way I seem right now. In the in-between time between the two interviews, they Googled me and saw photos of me with short hair. And when they called back, one of the first questions was also that, are you even sure this is a woman? And this was a question in spite of having ID cards which say female and all of that thing. And here the question of me, the way I identify doesn't even matter because the projection comes in there, is one. Two, the problem with the assumption that one certain types of gender cause harm to certain other types is, it's not untrue, it's definitely true. But it's also important to question when we use technology for safety, who are we leaving out and who falls through the gaps, right? Facial recognition, actually, there's a university in US which is experimenting with cameras outside women's bathrooms, and the cameras have facial recognition, so much so that if anyone who the camera reads as male comes towards the bathroom, it'll sound an alarm inside the bathroom and at the security guard center. Now, who does this leave out, right? In airports, again, same thing. The scanning thing, they say that it's gender neutral, but it's not. The person selects male or female, and that's when they scan the body, right? I don't know if women can hide like things better. Is that why you need to, like, I don't know if women and men's bodies can hide like suspicious material better or like differently. I don't understand what the point of it is, but that's how it is. And I think these are certain things which we need to think about in terms of who are we leaving out, what are the gaps in between which come up, and especially with facial recognition, because at the end of the day, and this is not just here, right? Like Facebook offers 56 gender options on the front end, but in the back end, it's still male and female. And my question is, how do they decide whether it's male or female, right? Especially when someone creates an account newly. Do they scan the millions of photos and then decide what happens there? Even things like, silly things like FaceApp, which makes your face older. Based on the way you hold the phone, it determines whether you're male or female and shows you filters only for that gender and not any other gender. So the reason I was saying this is because I think because in India particularly, the discourse of CCTV cameras and the 2,000 crore rupees put is only for like tech alone and tech for the safety of women, right? So it's also like who's left behind, who's left out, who's harmed more in the process of it, just to highlight that a little. Someone had questioned. Just we'll give turn to someone, yeah? Dahlia?
I just had a quick comment. I don't know if this was mentioned at all.
Do you
want to
come?
But there's actually an amazing project that is happening at MIT
That was Dahlia. Any other questions? There was someone sitting here who doesn't seem to be here anymore. But any other questions, comments? We have another 5 minutes. Shana? KS?
So I think in all of this, as we were talking about like centering people in this conversation, and then we went and looked at frameworks, and we went and looked at it from a very theoretical perspective, I think I was on a panel yesterday where someone was talking about artificial intelligence and its trustworthiness being something that their grandmother can understand, that you know someone who's not privileged to be in these spaces can engage with. So I think that's the kind of work I would like to see you see this project carry on with. And I remember I posed this question to you before of, in thinking about consent, also that balance of efficiency. It's kind of like, I'm going to give away my data if I'm going to get something better. So then the conversation becomes, as we're centering the body, how are people, if we were to say you're giving away your body, or the whole idea of people getting compensated back for the data they give away, how many people are going to be morally outraged by the idea of selling their body? Mm-hmm. And I think that is a way that you can then have the conversation going on, because the people who we're trying to engage with, us and our families and relatives and friends, is where I think we could actually mobilize this discussion a little bit more, because the data protection frameworks seem to be a language that's out there. And then how do we switch back that language to ensure that if we're centering the body, we also speak about it in a language that even my mother, who's engaging with algorithms, is actually able to be like, this algorithm is very problematic.
Thank you. KS, you had a question? Playing musical chairs.
I wanted to respond to your... Smita, your point about how technology leaves out some while including others. So, I mean, moving on from ontology to pragmatics, right? So what do we do to solve that problem? Do we include more people's data into the database so that now the facial recognition or whatever technology makes more granulated determinations about people. But what are we saying? That means more data collection. That means more data analysis about people. That means less privacy for all of us. So I think that there is a, everything has a cost. So, I mean, well, another way of creating more fair AI is not including more people's data in the database. Instead of doing that, maybe we can add some sort of a counter weighing factor that you know works against whatever biases that we may have detected. So I'm going to find out what that Justice League is doing in Cambridge, whether they are working on a post-processing solution or pre-processing solution. And I think that there, I think there's a vacuum on that discussion, how to make the technology more inclusive without costing people's privacy. I mean, Amazon shut down its AI hiring system after realizing that they don't have enough data on women who are successful you know, as a careerist. So they could not issue, you know, they could not hire. So does it mean include more, right? I mean, should Amazon go out and collect more data about women, right? So now, second point, just one more, about Agnes, I mean, don't take me wrong. I think it's a great paper, but because it's great, I mean, I think it's great because it is risk-taking. So, yes, data as resources is it's a bad concept. But we should also distinguish between data as libertarian or capitalistic commodities and also data as public resources. We are representing this feminist, kind of radical feminist website operator. Website is called Womad, who has used a mirroring strategy to show to men and the public what verbal abuse that women take by turning the narrative around. So, you know, there's talk of, there are a lot of talks, violent talks about cutting of dicks and, you know, all of that. And we see Womad as public resources. We see Womad, the website, the data, the flow of data around Womad as public resources to educate the public about, you know, feminism and all other gender issues. Same thing with, you know, Me Too revelations. Revelations, that is data flow. We are getting more information about what men in power do, you know, at higher echelons that we did not have access to before. So data as public resources is something that we should we should take a nuanced approach to instead of just, you know, pushing back all talk of data as resources.
Okay. Just a quick answer. I don't think, and it's a good question, like, is more data collection the answer? I don't think that's the answer. I do think my issue is not with the machine reading me wrong. My issue is what happens after that, right? A machine can see me as a man and say that I shouldn't go into the bathroom, but my issue is, after that, if someone comes and drags me out, that is my problem. So what are you doing with the data which you're collecting is the issue, because data is not absent of human intervention after that either. So I don't think, and similarly, like, the Amazon's facial recognition also shut down because it read a congressman, a black congressman, as a criminal as well. So it was much more than the hiring process itself was also problematic, but they were using more and more in police stations. So my issue is that when you rely on data more than people and you rely on data alone, and that affects people in very physical, very real ways, I think that's where the problem is. And interventions may not be needed in terms of collecting more data, because people did do that as well. They illegally, without consent, took videos of people who had uploaded, trans persons who had uploaded videos of themselves transitioning. They took it out of YouTube and tried to build an algorithm to understand how transitioning works. Whereas the truth is that it's not a linear process in all bodies, right? So the idea is not to encourage more data collection. I'm happy being off the grid. But I do not want the consequences of my data being misinterpreted, misread, coming on me and others like me.
But I think that's a really important point, no? Why do they need to collect that data in the first place? Mm. Actually, what you were saying about, like, why in the airport do they push that button, male or female, I thought that's a really good point, right? Because from a security perspective, does your gender matter? What matters is whether you have, what, a gun hidden under your clothes or something. So is it just so they know beforehand whether they're going to send you to a male or a female officer if you need to be patted down? But then they could just as well ask you, do you prefer to be patted down by a male or a female officer? I mean, so I think it's an example why, again, like, it's important to not assume that the data needs to be collected in the first place. And I think even with the public interest issue, we often have so little control over what is supposedly deemed in the public interest. I actually think my civic sense is quite healthy, but I still want to make a decision myself about whether I want to contribute my data to projects for the public interest. And at the moment, I have very little control over that. I think I'm probably going to repeat some of what I said, but the points that Smita was making really made me think again of In India, we had a very strong privacy judgment in 2017, and since then, which reconfirmed that we have a fundamental right to privacy under the Constitution, even though it's not written in the Constitution. And since then, we have a few positive judgments on privacy offline. So, for example, it's finally not criminal anymore to have gay sex in India. But we also, earlier this week, had a transgender bill passed in Parliament where actually to get a transgender certificate, you still need to go to a district magistrate and a committee will decide whether or not you are actually the gender that you say you are. None of us have to do that if we identify as male or female, so why would transgender people actually need a committee to decide for them what their gender is? We still have these struggles offline so much to really get bodily autonomy, to be able to take these decisions over our own lives. What is happening now, and I guess this is like why we think it's so important to put bodies in that debate is, and coming back to what Smita said, data is becoming a new frontier for us to where we need to fight that battle. And we don't have the language to fight it because we talk about data as a resource, as if it's disembodied, as if there is disconnect happening. And all of these examples that we have discussed show that actually in practice, that is not the experience of people. That is definitely not the experience of vulnerable people. Right? And also, like coming back to the algorithmic justice leak, I know they were among the ones who pointed out that a lot of facial recognition doesn't recognize the faces of black people, and there were a lot of black people who said, well, in this case, that's a feature and not a bug. You don't necessarily want to be recognized, right? Because if it is recognizing you better, those are the people who are going to be arrested more in the US. No, but this is true. Like, not being in the data is not by definition a bad thing. Sometimes it's good to fly under the radar. Sometimes that's exactly what you want, right? It's, again, I think it comes back to that question of boundary management, the control we have. To what extent do we still have bodily autonomy? To what extent is the digital undermining this further?
Sir, Anya, we have to clear the room.
Yeah.
All right, I'm sorry, we have to wrap up very quickly, but thank you very much, Anya, Ruhia, Chennai, Kyungming, KS, thank you very much.
And
thank you everyone here for joining us this morning and for a very, very interesting and fruitful discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you.